Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, pemirsa Republika. Bersama saya lagi Fitrian Zamzami dalam segmen News Story di kanal YouTube Republika. Belakangan kita tahu jalur Gaza sedang mengalami bombardir dari militer Israel. Sejauh ini telah menewaskan sekitar 139 orang, 37 diantaranya anak-anak. Dan pemboman masih terus terjadi dan kemungkinan masih akan dalam waktu yang tidak singkat karena Israel masih menyatakan akan melakukan pemboman terus, walaupun sudah diminta oleh dunia untuk berhenti. Nah, untuk menanyai langsung kondisi di Gaza saat ini, telah bergabung dengan kami Ibu Abir Barakat. Beliau merupakan pengajar di dosen UCAS di jalur Gaza, pengajar bahasa Inggris. Beliau sempat menempuh master di Universitas Putra Malaysia, dan saat ini beliau berdiam di Central Gaza. Jadi kalau kita ingin tahu apa sebenarnya terjadi dengan Gaza, mari kita langsung tanyakan kepada Ibu Abir. Assalamualaikum Sister Abir, how are you doing?
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh to you and to all our brothers and sisters in Indonesia.
Okay, first of all, let me, on behalf of Republika and all the people of Indonesia, send our condolences to people of Palestinians. May Allah grant all the shuhada jannah, and may the peace come soon to you all. So, first of all, we are in Indonesia would like to know, how is living in Gaza in a couple of days? How are you? How are your family? How are your friends? Did you fear?
Yeah, alhamdulillah. First of all, alhamdulillah for everything that comes from Allah. This is the condition of any Muslim, to say alhamdulillah, to thank Allah for the situation, whether it is good, whether it is bad, we say alhamdulillah. However, the situation is very difficult and it is escalating. It doesn't look like it is going to cool down. The situation is worsening actually with all the death toll is rising. The bombardment is everywhere. People are losing their homes, they are losing their businesses, their lives, their children, everything. So it is really difficult, and I don't know how to explain this or to tell you. We don't want people to feel sorry for us and to cry for us. We don't want sympathy. We want empathy. We want real support for us. We want you to feel, okay, you can cry for us in Gaza, for this our situation, but at the same time, you need to take action. You need to do something about it, because this is not the time to cry.
Okay, but if you could see how the life in Gaza, the daily life in Gaza right now, did you hear constant roaming of the airplane or the constant explosion of the bombing? Did you feel that way?
There is almost no life. We are confined to our homes with fear. It is difficult from the previous, for example, when you say there is a lockdown because of the coronavirus. This is completely different. During the lockdown, you are sitting in the comfort of your house, playing on your mobile, watching TV, watching movies, passing time. But now, this kind of lockdown is with fear, huge fear, because bombing is everywhere. You don't know where to go. You don't know what to do. When the bombing starts, you run to the windows and to see where is this. And we keep asking our people or our families, is this near you? Is this near you? We keep looking at the news and the updates all the time to know which area is being affected, because the bombardment is huge. Sometimes it is in the northern of Gaza, but you think it is near your house. This is the problem with these kind of bombs, because these are concussion bombs. They shake the ground as if it's there is an earthquake. And you in Indonesia know what is the earthquake. You know how volcanoes erupt? Yes. This is yes. Like it, I can say. Much exactly. Sure. So it's fear. Yeah.
Okay. So, have you have a good sleep lately?
No. No. Alhamdulillah, just now, because I just put my alarm on 11, because I have this meeting with you, 11 Gaza time.
Thank you very
I just
much.
Jumped off the bed. Let me give you this the example of this morning. Okay. Yeah. We haven't slept since yesterday. Okay, and we waited until Fajr time so that because you can't sleep and you have to pray Fajr. So we waited for the Fajr time, alhamdulillah, we performed the prayer and we decided to go to sleep at least for 2 hours. So from almost 4 a.m. in the morning until 6 a.m., 2 hours asleep. And we continue, we might continue a little bit until 9 because we don't have to go anywhere. So this would be like 5 or 4 hours, right? Good sleep. But just 2 hours until 6 a.m., the airstrikes started. And they were around my area, not far away from it. So we kept looking at the screens, sending messages to everybody. Okay. Then we thought it's over around 7 a.m. So we went back to sleep. And boom, another airstrike.
Oh,
my God. Okay. We wait in the sitting in the living room. And then after we heard the news, where is it, how many injuries, etc., let's go back to sleep. Another airstrike. So you never get sleep. And if you sleep, you sleep in, for example, for the women, like myself, I sleep like this with my full hijab.
Yeah. So you can run away if the bombing continues.
Exactly. And not only run away, it's also you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for satr. Meaning you ask Allah to cover your awrat, you know, when you ask Allah, please, Allah, if I go and if anything happens sudden this or anything like this, I'll be inshallah in my full satr, bi-idhnillah. And this is because we have tried this in the war of 2014, when the airstrikes started, you never know what happens and you run out. And I have seen women and girls, teenagers, were asleep and they were running in their pajamas and their nightgowns. And you know, the cameras were capturing for them. They were taking pictures of them and spreading it on the world news. So it's you know, this is not satr. So that's why, alhamdulillah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we sleep like this and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that to keep us, preserve us. And if we die, every day we have this in niyyah, we have this intention in our hearts. Allah, if I go, please accept me as shaheed.
I'm sorry, I can't contain myself. I'm sorry. And how is your Idul Fitri? How is your Idul Fitri yesterday? We hear in Indonesia that the bombing is continuing even when you are celebrating Idul Fitri.
Yes. When everything with the escalation continued, we didn't think that there would be Idul Fitri because they are trying to really to repeat the same scenario they did to us in 2014. So they want to deprive us from Eid al-Fitr. We didn't have anything related to Eid al-Fitr. For example, performing the prayer in the mosques or in the open yards, we didn't have it. So we just did the prayer inside our homes. Usually, you know, the children wear their new attire and get the idea from the parents. And we have sweets and candies and, you know, kuih, something like this. We didn't have any of that. But we said to ourselves, alhamdulillah, we reminded ourselves that the Eid is when we complete all the obligations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and all the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is Eid for us. Also, we know that, alhamdulillah, they didn't succeed in their plans in Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. So this is Eid for us. And then around the Duhur time, I told my children, okay, who wants Eidiyah? Because, you know, you want to cheer up the children. You don't want them to keep this gloominess. We don't want them to continue to have this as a negative memory. We want it to be a positive memory where they remember that we are powerful, inshallah. So they wear the new clothes. I give them the idea. And I'm sure, I don't know if you have this in Indonesia or not, when you give the children some money.
Yes,
so we give them the money. They were so happy. And alhamdulillah, kept reminding them that this is for Al-Aqsa. And inshallah, our next Eid will be in there. And we kept asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this. So there was no celebrations like visiting the relatives, having the beautiful Eid picture with the family. No, none of that. And in the early morning, they started bombing around. It's like they are giving us the Eid present. We knew that. Believe me, we knew that. We expect everything they do. And we knew. We said, yes, they will bomb us in the early morning of Eid and they will kill children. Because this is Yahud we are dealing with, subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran.
Sure.
Everything about them is mentioned in the Quran if you want to know your enemy. So don't tell me, we don't know they would do this or would do that. No. If you are a true Muslim, go back and read in the Holy Quran and you will know who are you who is this enemy you are dealing with.
Okay. So this latest escalation. We've been told that this is because the Israelis thought that they were only reacting to the Gaza rockets by Hamas. But we know that there is a certain incident before in the Sheikh Jarrah and Masjid al-Aqsa. Can you elaborate to us what actually happened in Sheikh Jarrah? Why that fiction put so much rage in the Palestinian? I think you, as an activist of the Great March Return, know this very well, right?
Yes. What happened in Sheikh Jarrah neighborhood, this is the main reason that instigated everything that happened. Sheikh Jarrah neighborhood is one of the neighborhoods in Al-Quds, in Bayt al-Maqdis, and it is in the heart of Bayt al-Maqdis. It's very close to Masjid al-Aqsa. And almost every year or every time the Jews or the Zionists, they attempt to evict or let's say ethnically cleanse the Palestinians living around the surroundings of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, so that no Muslim will be around Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, and I mean the parameters, the houses and the old neighborhoods around it. So they keep stealing homes from around that and stealing neighborhoods. And we have heard something, maybe in the media, if you remember, Khan al-Ahmar, this is another neighborhood that happened, the eviction happened in it in a few years back. And it happened also this time for Sheikh Jarrah. If Sheikh Jarrah was completely evicted and emptied by the Palestinians, this means you as a Muslim or as a Palestinian cannot move from point A to point B in Al-Quds unless you pass through this one. Okay, so this means complete, you know, sovereignty or a complete control of the Israeli neighborhoods in Bayt al-Maqdis. And that's why the people in the Sheikh Jarrah started telling the world to stand up with them, because this is another Nakba. And today we are celebrating the Palestinian Nakba. Today is, 15th of March. Oh. It marks the Palestinian Nakba. So if the people in the Maqdisi people in Sheikh Jarrah were evicted, this means another Nakba, because 50 families, almost 50 families will lose their homes. And this is number one. This is not the only incident that happened. So Sheikh Jarrah is number one. Number two, we were in the last 10 days of Ramadan. Okay. And you know the i'tikaf in these days, and we heard calls of the Maqdisi people saying that the settlers will intrude Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in the night of the 28th of Ramadan to celebrate the claimed unification of East Quds and West Al-Quds in the Israeli calendar. So if they did this, they will enter the Al-Masjid in huge masses, and we need to stop them. So they called for the youth and the elders and everyone who can reach Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa from all the parts of Palestine to come and do i'tikaf to and prayers and stay and never and not to leave the premises and the courtyards of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. Mm. So there were two incidents, not one. Okay. The evictions in Sheikh Jarrah and the i'tikaf or staying to prevent the intrusion of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in the night or in the day of the 28th of Ramadan. So this made all the Palestinians in every part of Palestine to be angry, even those who are under the Israeli control in the 1948 territories. And then the we had calls from Jerusalem, from Al-Quds, calling Gaza to support, because you know Gaza is the only place that Israel doesn't control. You know, we are in siege, but alhamdulillah, Gaza, you can consider it as, you know, standing on itself, and you know we have the resistance in here. So they started calling the resistance of Gaza, please help us. We looked up to your help. Please help us. So the leaders in Gaza said or threatened the enemy, if you do not stop what you are doing in Sheikh Jarrah and in Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, we will raid Tel Aviv with rockets at 6 p.m.
Okay.
And this flared the anger of the enemy, the Zionists. So then they started bombing Gaza with airstrikes. Airstrikes, bombs from tanks, you know. So we have by air, by land, and by sea. Also from the
water. Gaza is surrounded right now by attacks from air, land, and sea.
Exactly, yeah. And believe me, this is not a response to the strikes from Hamas. This is not just this is the chance they were waiting for, because they were making a lot of problems in order to end Hamas. They think they can end it, so they start bombing here and there, and they claim they are bombing centers for Hamas and etc. They were waiting for this chance for a long time. So you cannot say this is a reaction. It's not a reaction. It's a chance. That's all.
Because the Israeli has a lot of media support in the Western, and the news is that we keep getting is this is a reaction to because even the president of the United States say that Israel has the right to defend themselves. Doesn't Palestine have? How do the Palestine defend themselves right now? I mean.
First of all, looking at what Hamas is doing, it is the one that is having the power with the rocks they are sending there, and so this is something I can't talk about because I don't have information about. But as someone who is a citizen and a mother and a Gazan living in Gaza and having nothing, I'm a lecturer actually, a lecturer and a PhD student. We as civilians do not have anything to defend ourselves with. We cannot go to safe shelters. The only thing we protect ourselves with is dua to Allah. That's all. We have all the duas we need to do. We have the prayers. We perform the prayers most of the time, especially when bombing happens. And maybe, I don't know if you have seen the video that is the viral video that was spread yesterday about a family was taking shelter in the in their around the door in their house and the entrance of their house, and they were saying dua. The grandfather was reciting dua, and the children and the mothers were all replying. He was making this dua to comfort them, and suddenly boom. And the family, the video shows that the family was, you know, standing still in its place while, you know, the bombardment started. So alhamdulillah, you can see from the video that dua is what made them stay still and feel calm in their place. And something else that happens during your prayer, alhamdulillah, because we are together in the same house now, we as I told you, like a lockdown. We, alhamdulillah, perform all the prayers together. Most of the time, the bombing starts while we are in, you know, in the middle of the salat.
Okay.
And one of them happened while we are in the sujood position, alhamdulillah. And believe me, if I tell you, brother, it was the best sujood. At that time, yeah, alhamdulillah, you feel calm. When you are in the prayer, you feel calm, alhamdulillah. And I was asking Allah, if I ever die, take me on this position. So this is the only thing we protect ourselves with, dua.
Now you make me cry again.
Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah.
And then what we as Indonesian can do? We know you are working closely with Bulan Sabit Merah Indonesia. Do we can...
Yes.
Can we send some support or maybe help to Gaza? through this organization?
Yes. You can do a lot, actually. I don't like it when someone says to me, we can't do anything. Our hands are tied up. Please tell us, what can we do? You cannot just come to Gaza to support or to stand up in Gaza while it's in while bombardment to help us. There are many ships for helping. One of them is through this kind of Zoom, to show the people around you, to spread the news about what's happening, to spread awareness, because the social media is very powerful. It can, you know, stir people, and you can see what happened in the Arab Spring in 2011. The movements started because of social media. So never underestimate the power of social media or conventional media. So that's number one, spread awareness through media. Number two, we need you to keep us in your dua. Never stop making dua for us. And believe me, you don't think to yourself that, oh, we have been praying to Allah and making dua for 70 years plus and nothing happened. No, dua is powerful. And we can see the results ourselves, alhamdulillah. Number three, you can send financial support to help the steadfastness of the people and to help them rebuild their homes and rebuild their businesses. And I have seen this with the PSME. They did a pretty job during the 2008-2009 war. They brought with them also doctors from different specialties. And this is the time that I met Dr. Britta, Dr. Basuki. This was the first time for me to meet them. They came with a huge delegation of doctors to Gaza with different specialties and specialties that we need. And they performed lots of, operations for the injured from the war. So you can send the doctors, inshallah, once this is this war ends. And you can send financial support to help those whose houses were demolished, or even the hospitals. And Walan Sabit Mira did a great job in this. They also, I remember, they helped the hospital in the Shifa Hospital with the generator and by providing fuel for the generator there, so that the electricity won't be cut off. They had many projects actually, and they still continue with that. So financial support is another one. And if you can come to Gaza, if you can come to the Masjid al-Aqsa to pray there, to show your presence in the place, this is what we want you to do. Because showing your presence in al-Masjid al-Aqsa, bringing more Muslims to al-Masjid al-Aqsa, this means that the masjid will not empty. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدُ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْأَخِرِ. So we want you to be around so that if the masjid is empty, the Zionists will take it. But when you exist in it in huge masses and in most of the occasions, they will know that the Muslims will not, leave this masjid. So these are some of the things you can do as Muslims and as humans.
Okay. Sister Abir, I think our time is coming to an end, and we understand that you need to protect yourself constantly moving. What I want to say is we are in Indonesia is constantly praying for you.
No doubt
about that. We are praying for you every day, for your people, for your land, for your freedom. Inshallah, we're going to keep our support. As that being said, thank you very much for being here. Thank you very much for this interview. Untuk pemirsa di Indonesia, wawancara ini juga difasilitasi oleh Bulan Sabit Merah Indonesia. Can you speak Melayu? You have school to Malaysia, right?
Yeah, I studied in Malaysia around 1.5 years, but I just few things I can say, not a lot. Now I can say terima kasih semua, but a little bit. Yeah.
Okay, please say hi to your family, to your children, and to your husband. They're always in our heart. Inshallah.
Jazakumullah khairan. You're welcome.
Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.